Today we're speaking with Frances Fuller, who lived in the Middle East for 30 years and has written a book about her experiences called In Borrowed Houses. Author Jeanne Larsen describes Frances's book as wise, honest, sensitive, funny, heart-wrenching, and a compelling read. Frances Fuller has a sharp eye for human natures of all sorts, and she knows a great deal about how life should be lived. Who would think that the story of years spent in a war zone can make you laugh out loud? This one does, and then it goes much further. So, it seems that terrorist attacks around the world are increasingly drawing our attention. Just a few weeks ago, on December 2nd, 14 people were murdered with apparent responsibility of the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria in San Bernardino, California. On November 13th, 130 people were slaughtered in Paris. And around the same time, on November 15th, 43 people were killed in bomb attacks in Beirut, Lebanon. Now, Frances, you lived in Lebanon and the Middle East in general for 30 years. Can you tell us a little bit about how you ended up there and what you did there?
Well, yes. We were mission volunteers, and we came to the place where we had to decide where we wanted to go, and we chose to go to the Arab world. We learned after we made that choice that the mission board was thrilled because there were very few volunteers for the Arab world. Every Friday night in Berkeley for several years, we went to a big international gathering where there were people from all over the world. So we had a chance to see who do we relate well to, and when we stopped to think about it, we realized it was the Arabs. For some mysterious reason, there was this rapport that we had with the Arab guys who were going to the University of California and other schools. They were real upfront people. We always knew if an Arab liked us or he didn't. We were never afraid they were just being courteous or something, you know. We just related to them well. And so we chose to go to the Middle East. We studied Arabic at Georgetown University, taking just colloquial Arabic, and then we went to Beirut and we began to learn to read and write. We had 1 year in Beirut and then we went to Jordan. And my husband was instrumental in establishing a school in the capital city, in Amman. We lived in Jordan for 5 years, and in those 5 years, we went through the Six-Day War between Israel and the Arab countries, and then the Palestinian refugees created a conflict inside of Jordan, so that there was a year or more of serious fighting in Amman. And during that period of time, we went for a while to Beirut. And during that period of time, the director of a little publishing house that we had in Beirut died. And the publishing house needed somebody who was already on the field, somebody who had already studied Arabic, somebody who already knew something about the publishing program and had some vision for it. And so it fell on me by default. I had studied journalism. It didn't truly prepare me for the job, but some people thought it might. I came closer than anybody else, and I was willing. And so my husband agreed to transfer to Lebanon so that I could be the director of the publishing house. So I directed the publishing house for 24 years, and I established another publishing house under a different name, under a kind of a generic Arabic name. It's called Dar Manhal al-Hayat, which means House of the Source of Life. And that publishing house is still going and still reprinting things that I published as long as 30 or more years ago.
So, Frances, you've described Lebanon as the Paris of the Middle East and called it a microcosm of the Middle East. what makes Lebanon so important to this region?
The reason Lebanon is so important, there are several different reasons. One reason our publishing house was there was that Lebanon is a free country. You could do anything in Lebanon. You could hand out Christian literature on the street in Lebanon. And so we could print, and we had all the technical facilities, we had the technology, we had the freedom, we had everything that we needed to run a publishing house in Lebanon. Lebanon is the most sophisticated of the countries of the Middle East. And when I say that it's a microcosm, everything that you will find anywhere in the Middle East, it may be big in Iraq, you will find it somewhere in Lebanon. Everything that is anywhere in the Middle East, and I'm talking about a philosophy, I'm talking about an ideology, I'm talking about a political idea, I'm talking about food, languages, movies, styles, anything. Everything is in Lebanon. And so it kind of like connects the East and the West, because it at the same time it's a very westward leaning country. So Lebanon is a kind of a bridge. It's kind of like us and kind of like the Arab world at the same time. And it is the most diverse country. And the thing that the Arabs have not been learned is how to live with diversity. And Lebanon herself had that civil war, which really was in a kind of a fundamental way about diversity.
So you lived in Lebanon during the civil war, during some very violent times. You experienced this war, which lasted from 75 to 1990.
Right.
120,000 people died.
Right.
What was that like? That's
a big
question.
The war went all over Lebanon. There was always some place where it was safe. But every day we had to keep an ear to the ground. Every day we had to get up and know which road is safe, and which road are they kidnapping people on, and which road are they shooting, is the shooting, you know. And so the battle came to all of us at one time or another. And really, it was a very, very fearful experience. I have to admit that I was scared to death a lot of times, but never enough to leave. We always were every day hopeful. There were a few times when we thought we won't survive the night. There were a few times when we thought that. But then when you do survive, then you're suddenly euphorically happy, and you think, oh, it's great. Everything is great. Tomorrow will be better, you know. And so we never really wanted to leave. I had lots of narrow escapes. Anybody who lived through that in Lebanon has a lot of narrow escape stories. We weren't alone. There were 24 of us who stayed through the war, and God took care of all of us.
Now, Syria was occupying Lebanon during this war.
Right.
The war broke out in 1975, and I guess Syria invaded in 1976.
Yes.
And what was the Lebanese reaction to this occupation? Did they perceive it as well-intentioned by the Syrians? And even if it was well-intentioned, did the Lebanese accept it as such?
Well, when it was very interesting. When the Syrians invaded, they actually saved the Christians of Lebanon. There was this terrible, terrible battle that was between a Palestinian refugee camp and the Christian area in which we lived. Really ferocious battle when the Christians had made siege against the refugee camp. And the Christians nearly went under. They were losing. And the Syrians invaded and got between them and really rescued the Christians. And we were puzzled about that for a while. Then we realized that Syria did not want an Islamic state beside it. They didn't want to see Lebanon fall to a radical Muslim ideology. what the tyrants of the Middle East did, one of the ways they functioned was that they were afraid of radical Islam. They were secular governments. Assad's government was secular, like Saddam Hussein. And as a secular government, they protected the minorities who would have been in danger if there had been a radical Muslim group in charge. So they were enemies of the Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda and all the organizations that preceded ISIS. When the Syrians first arrived, the feeling toward them was fairly comfortable because of the circumstances. Yes. But then they stayed, and they stayed, and they stayed, and we got tired of the roadblocks, and we started to think, you know, this is my street, what right do you have? Even I'm a foreigner already, and I'm thinking, this is my street, and you're telling me that you have to search me, you know, on my way down to work. We had to stop at their roadblock on the way to work and on the way back, and they had complete control. If we didn't stop, or if we didn't stop as fast as they wanted us to, they could shoot us, you know. And so we start to feel like it's time for you to go. And then there is also the complication that there was a time in history when Lebanon, the territory that is Lebanon, and Syria was Greater Syria. It was all called Syria. And so the Lebanese feel rightly that Syria always kind of coveted Lebanon and wanted it all to be one country. And there were even people in Lebanon who had that view, that this should all be one country. So the Lebanese who didn't want that were very fearful when the Syrian army stayed so long, stayed for many years. And then the Israelis came, and then we started to wonder the same thing. Okay, you're welcome here for a few days, but you can go now. We're tired of you. It's time for you to leave. I really feel like any soldier standing in somebody else's street is going to be disliked very soon. No matter why he came to start with.
No matter how well-intentioned it was.
Right.
So you've talked a little bit about these secular dictators and how Syria didn't want to see Lebanon turn into a Islamic state, and that's
right.
Been one of their concerns.
Right.
And Syria has been a secular dictatorship for quite a while now, and currently it's ruled by the Assad regime. But in Syria, there's been a civil war
right.
That's broken out in 2011 to overthrow Assad
right.
And topple his regime. How does this conflict, in which now ISIS has joined the side of the rebels that are fighting against Assad, who's a secular dictator, how does this conflict impact Lebanon?
Well, first of all, it's right on the border. It's right there. And it's so easy for people to come across the border. It's almost like our border with Mexico, it is easy for people to find a way across, you know. And so anything that's in Syria can infiltrate into Lebanon. The whole situation is so complicated. And in Syria, there are all these different factions, and there are so many different factions in Lebanon. And in Lebanon, there's the Hezbollah. Hezbollah is a militia group that formed in the south of Lebanon with the support of Iran, which is Shia. And that regime has supported Assad. And Hezbollah has fought actually in support of Assad, and that is not the position of the Lebanese government, though Hezbollah has some power in the Lebanese government. And so it's all highly complicated. And even some groups, you don't know for sure whose side they're on. They're fighting against Assad, but do they like ISIS or not? Maybe they will go over and help ISIS when it benefits them in their fight against Assad.
And so Lebanon is in a really tough spot here.
Lebanon is in a very tough spot.
Lebanon is at enmity with Assad.
Right.
But ISIS is at enmity with Assad.
Yes.
But Lebanon doesn't necessarily want to side with ISIS.
Not at all. Not at all. And Lebanon, you see, having survived this civil war so long and so dreadful, 17,000 Lebanese people disappeared during the civil war. And nobody ever knew what happened to them. 17,000 people. There are all of these things that are still unresolved because of that war. The last thing that anybody in Lebanon wants is another war. Lebanon wants in every way possible to stay out of that. Lebanon doesn't want to be involved.